Welcome back. This is the Ben Shapiro Show. We're taking your calls at 855-236-3228. That's 855-236-3228. Joshua in Greensboro, North Carolina, you're on the Ben Shapiro Show. Go for it, Joshua.
Hi, Mr. Shapiro. I was wondering which of the Democratic candidates for president you thought posed the biggest threat to Donald Trump's reelection and why?
You know, I was thinking for a while there, as I said many times on the show, that it was Joe Biden simply because he's a dead person and unthreatening to people. And so all he would have to do is sort of just be that and then let Trump be the issue. But the fact is that Biden has proved himself so utterly incompetent on the stump, so unable to prevent himself from generating weird controversies that I'm doubtful that even he would be a real threat. I think that I'm starting to think that Amy Klobuchar would be the most trouble for Trump simply because she's actually won in a purple state. She's won a couple of times in a purple state. She's a little bit more moderate. She doesn't hate capitalism in the same way that the other Democrats do. Bloomberg, theoretically, might be a problem for Trump, although I think it's hard to say that he would be seen as a vast difference with Trump, another New York billionaire. But honestly, right now, you got to make Trump the heavy favorite for re-election. The person who I still think would be the easiest for Trump to defeat in the end would probably be Sanders, simply because Sanders is so wild and so crazy. And I think that the issue would then become, are you willing to give up all economic growth simply to punish Trump? Because Bernie is promising to destroy the American economy. I mean, not just hinting at it, promising it outright. So it's, I think Bernie would be the easiest for Trump to defeat, which is probably why Trump is trying to push him forward. It's why a lot of Trump fans are trying to push him forward. I don't like engaging in that because be careful of what you wish for. But I don't know, Joshua, where are you on this?
I was leaning towards Klobuchar myself after I saw Biden just fall apart utterly on the campaign trail. Like you said, going into the race, I thought Biden would have the best chance because he had a career in politics and was more moderate than the rest, but he's gone kind of crazy.
I mean, it's wild. It's wild to watch somebody collapse this thoroughly in the middle of a race. Joshua, I really appreciate the call. It is pretty incredible. Remember that Biden was the wire-to-wire leader. I mean, Biden was not only the presumptive nominee, he was the presumptive president. It's amazing to watch him fall apart this utterly, completely, simply because he is not a competent human being. But I guess maybe we shouldn't have been that surprised. He's run for president 3 times before. He's failed every single time. So maybe this shouldn't be so much of a shock. Daniel in New York, you're on the Ben Shapiro Show. Go for it, Daniel.
Hey, Ben. So with regard to student loan forgiveness, you know, it's like I disagree with wiping it away completely for obvious reasons. But considering that regardless of why, there's still people up the creek with, you know, without a paddle, you know, that they have that some people just have compounding interest and they'll never get to pay it off. You know, since it just keeps getting larger. What would your opinion be on maybe just freezing the interest after a certain rate or after a certain amount or percentage has accumulated?
Well, I mean,
also, Epstein didn't kill himself.
The problem with doing that is that whenever you try and put limitations on, you know, contracts that have already been signed, what you're doing effectively is you're saying going forward, there's going to be a fixed rate of interest. Well, if you set a fixed rate of interest, then people are going to have higher rates from the very beginning. Because here is the problem. If you have a variable rate, really, I took student loans for law school, and some of them were private and some of them were public. And if you take student loans for law school, then very often it starts off at a very low rate. Like my loan directly from Harvard was at a very low rate. And then over time, because they want you to start paying it back, they start to elevate the rate gradually. That's usually good for people who are getting out of school because you can't afford to pay these big student debts right out of school. If you were to freeze the increase in interest rates over time, then you'd instead get the interest rates front loaded because people are going to get their money one way or another. They're not going to take a loss on these loans, or they'll stop giving the loans entirely. There's always, you know, a cost that's not taken into account when we regulate these sorts of things. And the big problem with student loans in the end is that the interest rate is all you have because there is no collateral it's guaranteed against. A mortgage, you can at least say to folks, okay, well, you know, if you don't pay up, then we take the house. What exactly do you get to seize if someone doesn't pay their student loan, their degree? Like there's no material collateral that is put on the line against the student loan. So that's why messing around with the interest rates is pretty dangerous, Daniel. In terms of allowing future students to actually get low interest loans in the first place.
No, I mean, because, you know, it's like, with like Elizabeth Warren saying, we're going to give back all the money and all that. You know, it's like, I'm not saying that like all loans should be like that. I mean, like for the people, or, you know, like going forward, maybe like do something, I guess, about the loans, you know, like don't guarantee loans to people who can't obviously pay them back.
Well, I mean, for sure.
The people who are currently stuck.
Well, this is why the government, Daniel, I mean, I don't believe that the government should be in the business of giving student loans. I believe that you should have to make a case to a bank as to why your degree matters and why it's going to increase your income potential. And you should have to sit there and actually consider whether or not this is a good idea. We've created this sort of default system where everybody assumes that because They're going to college. They're going to be able to take out 150 grand in loans. No problem. They'll be able to pay it back. The government's going to back them up no matter what. And that, of course, is really silly. If you're going to do that, you should just go with a fully public sponsored system the way that they have in some European countries. If you're going to make it so that people are on the hook for their own loans and that people are responsible for their own educational decisions, then people should not be backed by the government in that pursuit. They should really have to go to a bank and make the case as to why your degree in lesbian dance theory is worth $100,000 in risk to the bank, as opposed to your degree in engineering. More people would go into professions that actually required an educational background of worth if they were forced to think about that sort of stuff, as opposed to going and get the liberal arts education that doesn't actually increase your earning potential. Daniel, really appreciate the call. Peter in Atlanta, Georgia, you're on the Ben Shapiro Show, line 6. Peter, go for it.
Hey, Ben, thanks for taking my call. I enjoy your show very much. My question is in regards to the deficit. After Trump's State of the Union speech last week, of course, the Democrats and other leftists went through it with a fine-tooth comb saying he's lying about this, he's lying about that. And one thing they harped on was the deficit, saying that during Trump's first term, he has done nothing to reduce the deficit, unlike Obama, who did. So my question is, what can we do as Americans, or what needs to be done to help to reduce the deficit?
Well, the answer is that the only thing that can be done to actually help reduce the deficit would be to cut spending. The only spending that would really make a difference in this scenario is not the discretionary spending, which constitutes something like 33% of the budget. It's all of the major structural programs that are mandatory spending. Social Security, Medicare, Medicaid, and those things cost a fortune. And the fact is that the deficit ain't going to drop unless we actually restructure those debts. That ain't going to happen anytime soon. By the way, when Democrats say that they lowered the deficit, that's just a lie. It's not true. What they actually did is they lowered the amount of debt that they were taking on a yearly basis. So in other words, if you take out $100 in debt this month and then you take out $90 next month, you have cut the deficit by their measure, even though you have taken out a total of $190 in debt, which, of course, is really, really silly. The bottom line is if you decrease the rate of your deficit, you have not actually lowered the deficit itself. What you've just done is decrease the rate of the deficit. And that's what Democrats are talking about under Obama, who blew out the spending. The Trump administration has continued to blow out the spending. Peter, really appreciate the call. Mark in San Diego, you're on the Ben Shapiro Show. Go for it, Mark.
Hi, Ben. I agree with you on most topics. However, when it comes to the Middle East, we kind of diverged. Mm-hmm. I'm originally from Lebanon, to put it into context. You have stated that Palestinian refugees that are third, fourth generation in Lebanon, Jordan, et cetera, would not be allowed back into their ancestral homeland. Why do you think that the Jewish people can claim as a reason to establish a country, Israel, in 1948, their history that extends more than 2,000 years into the past, but the Palestinians cannot when it was also their home for the better part of our modern history?
So the key distinction there, Mark, is between home and homeland, meaning that the Jews were only really welcomed into Israel once there was a Jewish state there, meaning when it was British Mandate Palestine, the British actually actively tried to dissuade Jews from coming into British Mandate Palestine, basically between 1920 and 1948. So the question is which regime, which government is in charge at the time. So Palestinians can definitely enter Palestine, right? That would presumably originally have been Jordan. Now that would include the West Bank and Gaza Strip, where Palestinians do live and where there are literally 3 to 4 million of them. So the question is not whether the Jews are allowed in areas that Palestinians are not, or Palestinians are allowed in areas that Jews are not. The question is which regime rules. Obviously, 20% of Israel is Arab, which is to say largely Palestinian. 0% of the West Bank, Judea and Samaria, the Gaza Strip, is Jewish. And you have to actually look back at the regimes that governed in these particular areas to determine who gets to live where. What I've said on the show before is that you don't have a right to settle in a country that is run by a regime that does not want you there inherently, right? That is not something that has ever been indicated under international law. The idea that you just get to settle in, you know, Sweden, right? You don't just get to go, like, Sweden gets to decide what its rules are. Israel gets to decide what its rules are. Jordan gets to decide what its rules are. And so the notion that you have, you know, 3 million grandchildren, great-grandchildren of people who once lived in this particular area, and they therefore have a right to live in their old home again, as opposed to in their quote-unquote homeland, which presumably would be areas of Judea, Samaria, and the Gaza Strip, that, of course, is untrue. That'd be equivalent to saying to Jews that Jews who are expelled from all of the Arab states back in 1948, and 700,000 of them were, that they have an absolute right to go back to their homes in places like Morocco or Iran or Iraq and just retake up their old homes. No, that's never been a thing in human history. The question under the British Mandate or under the Ottoman Empire is who was allowed there. Jews were allowed to settle there to a certain extent, not to an unlimited degree. And the original land division, again, that we have to take into account is that Palestine originally, the British Mandate Palestine, included Transjordan, and it also included Judea, Samaria, and Gaza. Israel kept accepting all of these deals that limited the amount of territory on which Israel could exist. The Arabs never accepted a single deal, and they've still continued never to accept the existence of a Jewish state period in any part of this area.
That's a lot to take in. I mean, at the end of the day, though, there's definitely people that do still believe part of Israel is their home or homeland. But I guess I could see where you're coming from at the same time. I guess we'll still have to disagree.
Yeah, no, I appreciate it, Mark. I mean, to me, it's the equivalent of people in the United States who say that once upon a time, the American Southwest was Mexican territory. Therefore, people have a right to cross from Mexico into the United States and turn California or Arizona into Mexico again. Right? I mean, this is actually part there's a group called Mecha that has advocated for this. Obviously, there is a United States government in place. You do not have the right to cross the U.S. border and simply establish a section of a Mexican republic in the state of California, for example. It's just not something that's ever been taken into account in terms of international law. Really appreciate the call, Mark. Mackenzie, in Montreal, Canada, you're on the Ben Shapiro Show. Go for it, Mackenzie.
Hi. First, I wanted to say happy Tu Bishvat.
Oh, I appreciate it. You too.
I'm surprised you're working on a holiday.
Yeah. Well, it's not technically a Yom Tov, so we're good.
Yeah, there you go. So my question is, I'm a college student, and I find myself worried about the prevalence of socialism in the U.S. What do you think is the solution to educating people about the necessity of maintaining civil liberties, which are openly restricted within the framework of the democratic socialists? And what are your projections regarding socialism in America? I'm worried, but do you think I need to be?
Yeah, I mean, I think that we should be very worried about the rise of socialism in the United States. People obviously don't understand what it is. Bernie Sanders constantly obfuscates, right? Bernie Sanders will say things like, well, if by socialism, you mean that we should all not live in trees, then sure, I'm a socialist. Like, no, that's not what we mean by socialism, dude. We mean nationalization of the means of production. And Bernie Sanders this weekend suggested that a government takeover of healthcare was not, in fact, a government takeover of healthcare when it is clearly a government takeover of healthcare. There are a lot of lies out there about this sort of stuff. Also, civil libertarians, you know, who ignore the impact of socialism on civil liberties are doing themselves a really grave disservice. And we've also conflated sort of the social libertinism of the social left with fulsome liberty. Now, you know, being able to do what you want in your bedroom is one aspect of civil liberties. But there are other aspects of civil liberties, like free speech, like free movement of goods and people, like the ability to own your own property, right? These are actual rights. And the fact that socialists don't seem to take those into account never occurs to anybody. The best way to educate people about this stuff is to talk about it, frankly. And the big problem right now that exists is that we are afraid to either teach about history or to talk about history. We keep buying into the notion that Denmark and Sweden and Canada, that these are examples of quote unquote socialist countries as opposed to capitalist countries with socialist systems. And also, it is important to recognize that socialism doesn't have to be an entire system in order to be damaging. In other words, socialism is just as damaging in part as it is in part, meaning the amount of socialism that you inject into a system speaks to the amount of civil liberties that are going to be invaded in order to effectuate that socialism. If you create a socialist healthcare system, you're going to have to invade the civil liberties of doctors. There's just no two ways about it. That does not mean a complete socialist takeover of the entire country, but programs that are taken over by socialism do involve a decline in liberty in those particular industries or areas of life. Mackenzie, really appreciate your call. Mason in Santa Cruz, you're on the Ben Shapiro Show. Go for it, Mason.
Hey, Ben. Just wanted to run something by you. I've been a foster parent we've had about a dozen kids through our home, and we've had third generation American children who don't speak any English. The problem I'm seeing is that these kids are being raised in a way that they're forced into slavery, basically, by not knowing English. So my proposal is a provisional green card where you come to America, great, we don't have enough kids, compliments to abortion, to take care of our jobs anyway. You come to America, you live for 3 years, you learn English in that 3 years, no misdemeanors, no felonies, no anything else, and you become an American citizen. And we quit trying to push people out who are here trying to work hard. And we do, I mean, I get that socialism is on a macrocosm is a nightmare, but on a microcosm, the social network is trying to put together teams of social workers to get these kids integrated. And the best way to do that, I see, is to get their families integrated and have them pay over-the-table taxes when they earn so that nobody's getting screwed by them being here.
I mean, first of all, I generally agree with the idea of giving people a pathway to citizenship so long as they're not taking taxpayer dollars and not committing crime and integrating into American culture. Again, the key there would be provisional, right? They actually have to fulfill these particular provisions in order to retain the green card, what we've seen lately is people being offered green cards while they are taking forms of welfare, while they are not learning English. So I think that the general proposal is basically correct. I think that it's a mistake, obviously, to have open immigration systems in a welfare state. But as I say, my key is the same with legal immigrants and illegal immigrants. Are they of benefit to the country? If you are of benefit to the country, then there should be a pathway to immigration status for you. If you are not of benefit to the country, then you shouldn't be in the country. And it is really that simple. Mason, really appreciate the call. Travis in Pennsylvania, you're on the Ben Shapiro Show. Go for it, Travis.
Hey, Ben. So I've been hearing a little bit of chatter about Hillary Clinton being on the shortlist for vice president candidate for some of the campaigns. So how do you think that would positively or negatively affect the Democrats' chance of winning the general election?
Well, I think that the chances that Hillary would ever run as VP are zero. I mean, she does not want that second slot. That is the last thing that she wants. First of all, she already thought of herself as VP under Bill Clinton. Second of all, she thought of herself as kind of quasi-VP under Barack Obama because Joe Biden was a non-entity. So I really don't think that Hillary wants that second slot on the ticket. I don't think that VPs also make a difference, broadly speaking. People tend to think that VPs win the home state of the state they are from. That is typically not true, or at least the proof of that is very scanty. Typically, a VP can hurt you a lot more than a VP can help you. So I think that Sarah Palin, for example, actually did not benefit John McCain. I think it's a mistake to sort of diversify your image by, like, John McCain and Sarah Palin obviously were not in any way aligned. It would have been much smarter for John McCain to pick Joe Lieberman as his VP. Republicans would have voted for him to stop Obama, and you might have had a shot at some of the moderates. I think that the likelihood of Hillary running as VP, very, very low. I who's going to pick her exactly? Who would is it going to be Bernie Sanders? Bernie hates her, right? Is it going to be Michael Bloomberg? Like, Michael Bloomberg doesn't want anything to do with Hillary Clinton. I think there's a much better shot that you see Cory Booker as VP or Kamala Harris as VP. They were basically running for that by the end anyway. Travis, really appreciate the phone call. Sean in Florida, you're on the Ben Shapiro Show. Go for it, Sean.
Hey, Ben, big, big fan. I'm a Christian guy. I'm getting married this weekend. Just want to address a little topic. I actually recently became a Trump supporter after 3 years of watching everything. A friend of mine, Democrat, he was bringing up an issue about the health care and about why we can't do it in America and why we should do it in America. And he was bringing up Australia as a standard. And I want to ask you why, or if you've looked at Australia as a standard for universal health care and why we should or shouldn't use that as a standard and why it wouldn't work in America.
So so basically Australia's system is actually kind of similar to the United States' system, except that it's Medicare for all who want it, right? It looks kind of look like the Pete Buttigieg system. The problem with Australian healthcare, just like the problem with any other system that is largely based on public funding, and you can buy private healthcare in Australia, is that if you actually want high-level healthcare, you do have to shell out of pocket for it. And that holds true in Australia just as it would hold true in a Medicare for all system, or Medicare for all who want it system. The United States is a heavily government-involved system, right? A lot of people are on Medicare. A lot of people are on Medicaid. The only difference is that it doesn't have a quote-unquote public option. The problem with the public option is gradually it does lead to the lack of either profit in the private healthcare system because you have to subsidize all of the public healthcare system, and that grows and it sort of takes away from the private healthcare system, or people end up having to shell out a lot over the top in order to avoid the public healthcare system. So a lot of the same problems people complain about in the United States actually are not fully covered even by the Australian system. So the sort of Australia as panacea, that I don't really see. It's actually the closest sort of universal healthcare system to that of the United States so far as I understand the Australian healthcare system. The fact is the United States healthcare system, when it comes to the ability to provide for care quickly and easily, is still the best healthcare system around. It's also really expensive. I mean, that's just the reality of the situation. If you are sick, you're going to pay money. It also means you get to see a doctor real fast. It also means you're not waiting in line. And it means that your 5-year cancer survival rates are the best on planet Earth. Really appreciate the call, Sean. Thanks so much.